So, the album that completely corrupted me and changed my life. Right here, Kiss Alive, man. I bought that album when I was 7 years old, on the day it was released. I wanted to get it before my older sister did, so I made that happen. And she had the first three Kiss albums, and we would listen to those and stuff. But I wanted this first, and I was 7 years old, and it was a big deal. And I think whether it's actually live or not, that's something else. But the illusion was perfect, and it became one of the most successful and most important live records of all time, and certainly influenced just about everybody in heavy metal. I mean, I can't even think of a band that wasn't in some way influenced by Kiss. So, this is a really, really cool, legendary piece of music here, or release. So there's that one. before Kiss, I mean, if I go back to this, this was actually some of my earliest memories. I mean, going back to being like 3 years old, my older sister was into this and Deep Purple and Zeppelin and, you know, so Black Sabbath, the first album. This is probably one of the most eerie, evil, heavy sounding records. I mean, certainly at the time, I don't think anybody was doing anything like this. The opening chords of the song Black Sabbath are, they define what was to become heavy metal. So they're certainly the godfathers of it. And this is it's a classic record for me, you know. It really goes back to, I remember being a really little kid and looking at this cover going, whoa, that's kind of creepy. But still was, it's almost like it was magnetic, you know, drawing me in. So great stuff there. I mean, this was later in my life, but Rush is an amazing band, and this I like many of their albums, but I would say this is probably 2112 is probably my favorite. It's got a killer production, still holds up today. Great, just amazing musicianship and songwriting, and you know, for a three-piece band, they sure as hell made a lot of noise. So very very cool stuff. Definitely takes me back. We got more Sabbath here. Paranoid, which is probably my favorite Black Sabbath album overall. Even though the first one really had a special impact from the amount of songs on this, with the exception of Paranoid, because I'm not a giant fan of that song, but everything else on the album is pure gold as far as I'm concerned. Iced Earth actually did a cover of Electric Funeral many years ago. I can't even remember why or what for, but it was a pretty cool thing to do. And what was this? I think this was Sabbath's third album. Second album. Okay. Yeah, because Master of Reality was third, right? Yeah. Okay. But it was a big step, you know. I mean, in terms of production and songwriting and everything, and you could, to me, it's, I think, an overall amount of great songs on a record, it's hard to beat a lot of classics on here. And this also came later. Van Halen. I'm not actually a giant Van Halen fan, but this album kicked so much ass, and the Eddie Van Halen's playing was so revolutionary. I remember the first time I heard You Really Got Me, it was a pretty big hit in the States. And I mean, I know it's a cover tune, but there was no guitar that really sounded that way. And I the one thing that I really appreciate about, besides the production of this record, the way Eddie Van Halen plays guitar, I mean, he's one of the greatest guitar players ever to live, there's no doubt. But I think the thing that makes him so special is he's such a killer rhythm player. And you can actually hear that in the solos, where a lot of times those two things don't necessarily coincide, but with Eddie, it pours from his soul, and when he's doing all of that lead stuff, it's in time like nobody else. And that's a really very, very rare thing, trust me, because I've been recording guitar players and working with lead guitar players a lot. So this he is an amazing player, and that debut album is it's classic, you know. This actually, Number of the Beast, is my all-time favorite record. Not just by Maiden, just in general by anybody. When I got this, was my first exposure to Iron Maiden, and when I got this, I was just blown away. Like, it was a life-changing event, because before this, it was, even though I saw Judas Priest in 1979 open for Kiss, they were probably my first exposure to the new wave of British heavy metal, but they didn't like grab me and jerk me out of my seat like Iron Maiden did. So I got into the Priest, I think that was the Hellbent for Leather tour that they opened for Kiss on, and I got that record and it was cool and I liked it, but when I discovered Maiden, that was like definitely a life-changing event. The speeds, the guitar harmonies, the soaring vocals, the killer artwork, they had the whole thing. And then I went back and got into the first two albums, and those are my three favorite Maiden albums, you know, for sure, by far. But this is definitely the one. It's the one. You know, it's like, it's one of those things when you fall in love with a band, you always want them to recapture that moment, and they're never going to be able to, because that exists in your head, you know. So, but I love all their stuff. I love some albums more than others, but yeah, this is the one. You know, and the new wave of British heavy metal obviously had a big influence on Iced Earth, and the later Priest stuff. I love Screaming for Vengeance and Defenders of the Faith. You know, I mean, those are up into some of my favorite albums of all time too. But they really took them a much longer period to develop, as far as I'm concerned. Whereas Maiden, pretty much right out of the gates, were badasses, and I just didn't discover them until this record. So, and then we move on to some here. Pink Floyd now. It's also been a very influential band for Iced Earth, believe it or not. I mean, even though, you know, we're pretty heavy, and we still have those dynamics that I think can directly be attributed to being influenced by Pink Floyd. It's the whole idea for me of songwriting, or even given the flow of a record, I want to take the listener on a journey with peaks and valleys, and not just have kind of one sound through the whole album. I want to take them on a roller coaster ride, and a big part of that dynamic influence is it comes from Pink Floyd. And you know, this album is amazing. The Roger Waters is probably in my top three, you know, heroes of music of all time. As far as a songwriter and a visionary, especially back in the day, he was on fire, and that certainly had a lot to say. And I think this album is so relevant still today. He did a recent tour. I'm sure everybody knows about that. The Wall, the new production of it, and I saw it, and it was the best show I've ever seen in my life. So, really cool stuff there. And then we go into AC/DC, which was also a band. I mean, there's so many. I love all their albums, the old albums all the way up through. For those about to rock, or you know, they're all classics as far as I'm concerned. I just pulled this one out because it's so hard. You know, you don't want to go through the whole catalog, but this is obviously. I don't know how big this was in Europe compared to the States, but this was their breakthrough record in the States. They did really well, but this one was the one where they got really big. And then Back in Black was that they exploded on that one. But you know, I listen to this. This is like the soundtrack of my childhood. these songs, man. I can. That's the amazing thing about music. It has such a powerful imprint on you, at a specific point in your life. I can hear some of these songs, and I can remember making out with my girlfriend. I can remember the smells, the taste. What it's like. It takes you right back there. And there's not really too many things in your life that can do that. That's the power of music. It's really amazing. So when I get in these phases too, where I'll be like, I want to hear AC/DC for a month. You know what I mean? I just listen to their back catalog, and I'm going through that. And I do that with Kiss, and I do that with a lot of those things. And then I won't listen to it for a year or two, and maybe hear a song here and there. But I get in these moods where I'm like, I gotta hear AC/DC, man. I gotta get on that, get my fix, you know, and just it always takes me right back. That's my favorite Metallica record. Also, when I discovered Metallica, so it's one of the, again, that initial impact of a band that really hits you, and then you always want them to redo that. Can you please do this album 20 times in your career? Yeah, it's not going to happen, but that was a very magic moment for the band. As you know, I enjoy a lot of their stuff, but to me this was revolutionary. This is kind of like what it was, the next, you know, there was Maiden, from you had the Sabbath, Deep Purple era, and then you had the Maiden and the Priest era, and then you have this, you know. And these guys took it to a whole, they had the melody, the speed, much more angry, much darker, and it really obviously rocked the world, because they're the phenomena of heavy metal, the Beatles of heavy metal. There's nobody who's ever going to be bigger than Metallica, which is amazing when you think about it, because this shit was pretty heavy, you know. So it's awesome. That's a classic record right there. Oh, we got another Maiden album. I just grabbed it because, I don't know, I mean, that's Killers, their second record. I know it's probably not one of the most popular albums, but I think it's awesome. I love the first three. Again, you know, it just takes me back, and you listen to the song structures of this stuff. It was really something for the day. I mean, they were taking everything to a whole new level. And I think there's a lot of bands that do that, but then they overthink it and they do too much. And when you hear this stuff, it's pure and it's honest and it's still focused, and it's not so over the top that it becomes hard to listen to. I mean, it's actually pretty easy to come up with a million different riffs and complex arrangements, but I don't know that that's necessarily good if it's not grabbing you by your heart and squeezing it, you know? I mean, that's the whole point of music, is to try to speak to somebody, to grab them and shake them at their foundation. If you just do complex arrangements because you want to do your musician masturbation thing, then okay, you know, that's fine, but there's a lot of people that can do that, so it's not very special. And then this. Philip found this here. I'm buying this because I don't have this, believe it or not. Or at least I haven't found it yet. It could be buried in the archives, which we still have to go through. But I have all the other albums on vinyl, and I want to get them framed and hang them in my office. And so Philip's like, hey, check this out. And I'm like, dude, I'm buying it. So that's cool. So yeah.